Yeah, 42 years as an academic, right? So I started working on these types of projects early in my career, and I've always taught PhD courses about them. And last year, when I was when I was doing my PhD course for empirical asset pricing, I covered this Cochrane and Piazzi term structure model, which is a very famous 2005 model of the term structure, and had a number of ideas about what might be done to investigate it. And you know, I realized first of all that there was more data available. So they stopped in 2003, and we now had up to 2016 data from 2016. You know, so you could just sort of see how the model might be performing, and the intuition there was that it was probably going to fall apart, right? Because the financial crisis was so different than the period over which the model was estimated. But there were also additional currencies that they didn't investigate. So I got data on the G9, so left out New Zealand because data weren't particularly high quality. And then I realized that there were a number of foreign exchange implications that could also be investigated that they had not looked at. So the Cochrane-Piazzi model is a forecasting model for the rates of return on government bonds, on zero coupon bonds. So let's see. So let's put up a little notation here. So I was gonna do a slide on bond math, and then I thought, nah, they don't want to see that. But but the holding period return on an N period bond. On an end period zero coupon bond, that's just, you know, you buy it at PTN when it has end periods to maturity. It pays off a dollar in end periods, and then you sell it in the future, and it now has N minus one periods. You know, so that's what RX is the continuously compounded excess return on a bond, and N here is going to be N is going to be 2, 3, 4, or 5 years to maturity, and the idea of the model is that you can project these excess returns onto some information, and you know, the information I'm using is forward spreads. So at any point in time, there's forward rates implicit in the term structure of interest rates that tell you information about the future, and then I'm subtracting off the current one period rate to get forward spreads, and I'm actually averaging across not only today's forward spread but last month's and the months before that, so just getting some average forward spread. So that's what the right hand side variable is. It is the average of four forward spreads, and then there's a constant term also in the regression as one of the variables. So this is, you know, gamma transpose times the vector of forward spreads. That's five elements in the regression. And then what they do is they say, well, if you ran each of these each of these excess returns, if you ran those on the five forward spreads in an ordinary least squares regression, you would have an unconstrained forecast of each excess return. And what Cochrane and Piazzi realized was those unconstrained forecasts had a factor structure. It looked like there was a common factor. And so they estimated this model. They proposed this model, and it ends up being the same model that Lars Hansen and I developed in 1983, which is to say that there's a reduced dimensionality to this these five models. So rather than having Rx t plus one two is equal to gamma one. 1, 2 plus gamma 2, 2 times FS 2 plus gamma 3, 3, 2 FST 3 plus dot 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 gamma, four. I guess I didn't need a dot 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 that. to fs t2, plus an error term, and then have this, same thing then through rx t plus 1, 5. There would be 20 unconstrained coefficients, and then this model says, well, I'm gonna estimate the gammas from the average of the four excess returns, and then I'm gonna take 2, 3, and 4, or 3, 4, and 5, and estimate separate separate parameters there, and that gives you this reduced factor structure. So what do we look at? If they had done this in 2003, they just looked at U.S. data, and this is very similar to what they found. So you find that that beta 2 is 0.46, beta 3 is 0.86, and beta 4 is 1.23, and then the gammas the gammas are quite significant. You do a chi-squared test on is there time varying forecasting ability? Yes, there is. It's, strongly rejected, and you get an R squared of 39%. And then the interesting thing was that if you look at the, why would you estimate this reduced factor model? Well, if you do each of these equations simultaneously, and then you look at the percent of the variance that's explained by the expected four expected returns, a single factor explains 99.7% of that variance. So it's this very strong one-factor structure in the term structure of interest rates in terms of its predictability. And the nature of that risk is really that the level of interest rates is going to change. So they say, very, very common sense thing that all of these bonds are exposed to changes in the level of interest rates. How much of that exposure, ends up being to the 2-year bond, well, not as much as the 3-year bond or the 4-year bond. That's why you're getting these increasing coefficients. And then, what happens if you look at other countries? Well, you've got the pound, the euro, the Swiss franc, the Canadian dollar, the yen, the Aussie dollar, the Swedish krona, and the Norwegian krona, and you see there. The same 99% structure, the first principal component of the four expected returns that are all projected on the same information. It doesn't have to be that. It could be that there were four factors in these other countries. I was shocked that this worked so well. There are different gammas, so the gammas are not all the same. But the Bs are very similar. The Bs have this exact same structure and are very highly statistically significant. And the U.S. Came in with 39%. The sample's very short here for the Norwegian krona. So in the paper we actually say just ignore this. We just sort of estimate it for completeness. The starting dates are different for all of these currencies too. So they all end in the end of 2003, but the data start at different points in time. The U.S. sample starts in the 1960s. Okay, so what happens to the model then if you take it out of sample? You take it to the 13 years from 2004 to 2016. Well, that one-factor structure, still holds up pretty well. It falls off a little bit, but there's still, there's still predictability, in these chi-squared statistics. The betas, the Bs, they look pretty similar. They're a little bit smaller, but not terribly terribly different, and the gammas. The gammas are quite different. What we do in the paper is we want to do a test. Would you be able to reject the hypothesis that the Bs are different from the pre pre-2003 sample to the post-2003 sample, you get some rejections of that. You reject that for the euro. You reject it for the yen. You can't reject it for the dollar or the pound. You can reject it for the Swiss franc. But the gammas are generally more different, and in particular they're quite different for the dollar. Now, in teaching the class last year, I realized that they had not investigated the international implications of this model. So bond pricing runs on the idea that there's a stochastic discount factor. So why do people look at this? Well, the modern asset pricing all runs on the idea that there's an equation that the conditional expectation of some stochastic discount factor times the return on an asset has to be equal to one, and this equation has to hold for all assets, and in particular it holds for these holding period returns on bonds, and so the bond pricing gives you an enormous amount of information about what the properties of the stochastic discount factor are, and this is for dollar returns, but then there has to be one of these stochastic discount factors, for the euro also, and that has to equal one, and so when you look at returns on in euros, you're getting information about the euro stochastic discount factor. When you look at returns in dollars, you're getting information about the dollar discount factor. When you're looking at dollar returns on euro assets, you're getting some information about both, and so what we were able to demonstrate, and won't bore you with the algebra, is that this x here, so let's talk about what the data are. So exchange rates are currency j per unit of currency I. So this is the excess return from borrowing a unit of currency I, lending that, converting it into an amount of currency J, getting interest on that at RJ, and then this is the rate of appreciation of currency J. So you'd hope that that you'd get appreciation, and uncovered interest rate parity would say, well, you're not going to get that. You're just, this end is going to end up being negative, and it's going to offset the interest differential. And we've known for a long time that doesn't hold. And then we were able to demonstrate that this gamma, that the predictability that's in the term structure in the Cochrane and Piazzi model, that single factor we're calling X here, and so. If this is dollars per euro, then the dollar Cochrane Piazzi factor and the euro Piazzi factor and their squared values should enter into this ability to forecast the excess return, and so this is a sort of test of the integration of these markets. You would think that the bond markets in the two countries would be pretty highly correlated with what's going on with the exchange rates. And when we look at this in the pre-2004 sample, so this is something that could have been done then that would have been a sort of test of the model, we find it's pretty much a failure. The coefficients, so we do two tests here, three tests, are the coefficients on, and this is for the dollar values of the currencies. In the paper we have all of the cross currency considerations. So we have the pound euro and the Canadian dollar, Australian dollar. We got all that. I'm not going to show you that. These are just the dollar exchange rates. And so this is, you know, it is the level of the Cochrane Piazzi factor and its squared value, you know, are they significant? Are the pound Cochrane Piazzi factors significant? And are all four significant? And basically, you know, these are the angled brackets are p values, and you just don't see much. You know, you see, you know, for the yen, you know, it kind of worked for the yen. We got 38% predictability, but very low predictability in general from these estimated term structure factors that ostensibly should have performed well. When we look, take it out of sample, we don't find much in terms of any predictability at all. And I should have said earlier that all of these are annual forecasts. So the original model was done on forecasting annual excess returns. So this is forecasting annual currency returns, and it's all done with overlapping data where you go ahead a month, forecast out a year, go ahead a month, forecast out a year. So this left us with the feeling, well, maybe it's because uncovered interest rate parity sort of works, and so we related this to the literature on the carry trade. The carry trade says borrow low interest rate currencies and lend high interest rate currencies, and hope that the high interest rate currency doesn't depreciate more than the interest differential. And and the sort of standard regression that demonstrated that worked was that you would take the interest differential of currency I minus currency J and regress that on the excess return that you would earn from borrowing I and lending J, and then hoping that you don't get the depreciation of currency J to offset that. And so if you looked at that pre-2004, you found nice positive coefficients there on phi one. So that says you put a positive coefficient in here. It says if the interest rate is high in currency J, do the carry trade. Well, that's exactly what you find here in all of these dollar currencies, that when interest rates were higher in those currencies, it was a good time to do the investment. And and so that simple model gave you reasonably high R squareds. When you look out a sample, put in the financial crisis, what happens? Well, those nice positive fees have now flipped to big negative values. So sort of well known that the carry trade fell apart during the financial crisis, and that's what we see here as well. So conclusions. The 30-year sample from 64 to 2003, both bond returns across G9 countries and relative foreign currency returns appear to be highly predictable. The one factor model appears highly plausible, with the risk being the change in the level of the general level of interest rates. The Cochrane-Piazzi model also appears to hold in the term structure literature for 2004 to 2016, but the coefficients are different. And when we also in the paper recursively forecast out a sample. So we estimate the model up to time t, take those coefficients, forecast out a year, estimate time t plus one, forecast out a year, and the model does not beat just saying that the base forecast is the average return up to time t. So the model does not forecast out of sample for the 2004 to 2016. And neither does it for the currencies. And then the FX implications of the model also failed in the original sample as well as the out-of-sample period. So the FX risks appear to be poorly integrated with the term structure risks, which was somewhat of a surprise to me. And then the carry trade, you know, also collapsed during the financial crisis, so one of the things that I've harped on throughout my career is that a bunch of this stuff might be unstable, and that this, you know, just need incredibly large samples to do inference. Okay, thank you very much. Be happy to answer any questions.